I've done this before. So areas set aside for biodiversity conservation, like parks or natural areas or conservation areas, and this differs from country to country, but places set aside for these purposes we like to think of as being wild, being totally unfettered and unregulated. But the truth is that they're affected by humans constantly, all the time. If you think about the effects of climate change, if you think about the effects of air quality, if you think about the effects of water quality, there is no such thing as a place outside of human influence. Even wild places have heavy human influences. So some kind of management is almost always necessary, even if we think of the place as wild. Humanization, that is, the human influences, require us to be responsible even for wild places. Regulation, managing use, and managing access. The problem is that human influences are so numerous and so diverse that there's no way to implement a regulation or an access rule or some kind of use without creating winners and losers, meaning some will benefit while others will not. And this is true, there's no way to undo that. It's an inevitable part of the management of wild things. So political ecology is a research program designed to take apart and examine who wins and who loses under different kinds of regulatory authority. Where does the value flow by damming a river or undamming a river, for example? In both cases, you're changing nature, but in either case, you're producing a different flow of value. So before we can make a decision, we have to analyze who wins and who loses. Where are the political struggles over these outcomes? Political ecology is a way to ask and answer questions before you make what could be bad decisions. And that makes it very powerful. So one of the greatest challenges in conservation is that much of wild nature, the things we want to conserve, are not in protected areas. They're not in parks. They're not in wilderness zones. They are in cities. They are in farmland. They are in forests that are managed for timber. In other words, nature conservation is no longer just about setting aside areas for protection. It's about thinking about where wild things are out in where people live. Again, cities, farmland, places that people use. So historically, conservation has been about thinking about setting aside and controlling zones. Now, it's about operating everywhere. So the challenge in the future of conservation is working with private landowners, working with local government agencies, working with urban planners. These are places that conservation scientists used to never go. They think of themselves as working out in wild nature somewhere, but now conservation science has to enter into these zones where people live and work. That's a huge challenge. And if you couple that with the changes that are going on in the environment, changes in rainfall, changes in temperature, changes in sea level, so the entire system is changing. Scientists are now working in places they're unfamiliar. They have to talk to local people. They can't just order people around in some authoritarian way. You have to work with communities at a local level to produce some kind of outcome, all while everything is changing. This is an enormous challenge, and it means conservation scientists have to think differently about biodiversity protection. They need to think about it as a human problem and not a nature problem. We are going through the largest mass extinction of species in the history of our own species. The last time there was a loss of biodiversity this great was before humans were on the planet. And we are driving this mass extinction. So they are often losers amongst the plants and animals, the endangered species. But I would say that in many cases, you can have winners. If you look at what's happened in North America, wolves are coming back into the landscape. In some cases, they're deliberately being put there by biologists. In some cases, they're simply adapting. They're getting smarter about living around people. In India, panthers, beautiful cats, were pushed to near extinction. Well, now they're coming back. Why are they doing so well? It's because they know how to live around farms. They know how to live around people. So this mass extinction is a very terrible story, but there is reason to be optimistic that there's ways to work in and around nature so that the plants and animals aren't always the losers. Yeah, does that help?
Yes.